an amazing story. I'm thrilled that David and his partner, Paige, are here. David's going to talk about his journey, about becoming a vegan, how it impacted his health, and his current advocacy work with vegan outreach. So everyone, please give a warm welcome to David Hartman. Yeah, we want the wireless.
Bears, Raiders, I've been around. I played as a D lineman, and today I'm going to tell you about my story, but later I'm going to talk about food oppression. So I'm going to give a brief, story about myself. And I started out eating meat like everyone else. I grew up playing football, playing sports. I have a brother who plays football. He plays with the Ravens. And we grew up competing all the time in absolutely everything, sports, eating, who can eat the most. And I feel so sorry for my parents because their grocery bill was ridiculous. And, you know, at least $500 every time they go to the grocery store because they're buying meat and juice and everything for two big football players and three other people that eat less than we do. Anyway, doing all that, eating all the meat and drinking all the dairy, it works for me. Like I said, I got to the NFL, went to college, got a scholarship to UCLA, and went to the NFL, and I was 305 pounds, but second year into my career, I started having health issues. Oh, I forgot. And this is the team that I played for, that's me. I forgot I was using this when I got into the talk. And that's me, the Cardinals, the Jags, and the Cowboys. And so, but the second, third year into my career, I started having health issues, that you shouldn't be having at the age at the age I was, which was 23. I started suffering from, what's the thing? Okay. I was suffering from illnesses that I shouldn't have been doing, or I should have been suffering from, like tendonitis. Tendonitis, muscle fatigue, loss of feeling in my right arm. I had a shoulder injury in college, and it just kept getting worse and worse as time was going on. I had ended up getting nerve damage in my right arm, or I couldn't feel it from time to time, or it'd be shooting pains in there. I had high blood pressure, early onset arthritis, and this is all before the age of 23, or this is all at the age of 23. I also couldn't feel my right hand, part of the fingers of it, my pinky finger, index finger, and ring finger, not index finger, middle finger and ring finger. I couldn't feel them. I had to tape it to my index finger just to make a fist and play after that. So I was all kind of jacked up at 23. A lot of these people are like, what does the food have to do with all of this? But a lot of these things are food-related illnesses, tendonitis, muscle fatigue, high blood pressure, early onset arthritis. These are food-related illnesses. I went too far. So I went vegan, I ended up having to go vegan because of these illnesses. I did all that. I had early onset arthritis. I had all this stuff going on. And then the third year of my career, I was like, you know what? I need to make a change. I can't continue to play like this and have all of these illnesses, tendonitis, high blood pressure, blah, 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 at 23 years old. And my wife had been vegan for 6 years before me. And she was always in my ear, hey, you should go vegan. You should go vegan. And I was like, shit. I'm not trying to be skinny I've seen that. I don't want to be. Where am I going to get my protein from? I was brainwashed like everybody else. I had no idea what protein was. And to my knowledge, protein was just meat and milk, the day before Valentine's Day, February 13th, it was movie night, and my wife and I were watching Forks Over Knives. My wife decided to watch Forks Over Knives. And for those of you who don't know about the documentary Forks Over Knives, it explains how meat and dairy cause a lot of the food-related illnesses that we have today. And they use the China study to help further their point. And it talks about lactose intolerance and how the body, if you're lactose intolerant, has a hard time digesting milk, and how milk causes leaches calcium from the bones because it's so acidic to the body and all that. And this was happening while I was drinking a milkshake. And I was like, okay. okay, well, at that point, I went to the kitchen and I just poured the milkshake out, emptied out the refrigerator, took everything out, and I was like, I'm going to eat that tonight. And that's what I did. I made, I jumped in the water with both feet, but I didn't know where I was going to get my protein from and everything. I had to do some research. And I found out that what protein was, and a lot, like I said, I didn't know what it was. Protein is not meat, it's not milk. Protein is made in plants through a process called photosynthesis. And protein is just an accumulation of amino acids. And then when you get those amino acids together, you have a protein. So anything that has chlorophyll in it, anything that grows in the sun has protein in it. A strawberry, banana, oranges, apple, beans, all of these things have protein in it. That's why when you look at animals today, or animals at all, period, and even in history, the largest dinosaurs, the largest animals we have, elephant, gorilla, are all plant-based, and they all don't seem to have any protein issues. So, anyways, and that's it. But when I went vegan, after I went vegan, I was 305 pounds when I went vegan. A month later, after going vegan, I lost 40 pounds, and I was like, oh shit, I'm going to keep my football at 265. And my trainer, he was like, bro, what's going on? I told him to go vegan. He was like, are you serious about this? You're going to go vegan? I was like, yeah, just work with me, bro. And he's like, all right. At the end of the month, I lost 40 pounds. I was 265, and I was looking good. I was all cut up and everything. It's summertime. I'm about to go to the beach. I'm good. But, I was worried about my weight being lighter than I was supposed to be. Playing defensive lineman in the NFL, you're just not going to cut it if you're not 300 pounds, or at least 290-something. So I was worried, but then I started working with my trainer, and he was like, all right, we're gonna do max outs. Before I was hurting, I had all these issues, the tendonitis, the nerve pain, and all that stuff. I couldn't bench press 315 pounds for a set of five, which isn't a lot for me in my size. But after I went vegan, a month later, my bench press, the tendonitis had gone away, nerve damage had went away, my right hand was getting strong, and it was almost stronger than my left hand at that point. I was able to bench press 465 pounds at the end of the month. Got it on video, because my trainer was like, do that again, because I don't believe you. And then I was leg pressing 800 and 1800 pounds for a set of 10. And that was at the end of the workout. So it went from 800 pounds, 900 pounds, 1200, 1500, 1800 pounds, all for a set of 10, all in within like 45 minutes, like, you know, a workout, whatever. And it was like, I definitely, saw benefits from switching over to a plant-based diet. All right, so I'm not here to talk about myself the whole time. And it's a cool story, but I want to talk, my main goal up here is to talk about food depression and what we're dealing with today. And what is food depression? That's a good question, because a lot of people don't know what it is. You think, they don't have enough money over here to eat. No, it's way deeper than that. So, food depression is a structural perpetuation of race and class-based health crisis implemented through target marketing, infiltration into schools, government subsidies, and federal food policies. Now, it's important for us to know how these things shape our society today, what we're dealing with, and why our communities are the way that they are, why we have ghettos, why they have nice areas, why they have food deserts in the grocery stores in some areas, and bodegas, and that's it, ice cream trucks, and urban cities, urban areas. So, last couple weeks ago, I did a presentation in Baltimore, and I did a little field trip. I went around and I was taking pictures of the local grocery stores in the hood, the urban grocery stores in the food deserts. And as you can see, this is the produce section of these urban food markets. There is no produce. I don't even know what this is. That's not a fruit, right? Though, but there's fruit on it, and that's what's deemed as the fruit and produce section. This looks like a meat rack, like a meat thing or something in a meat department, and it's full of fruits and vegetables, and this is the fruit department in the grocery store, and this is consistent, and not just in Baltimore. Baltimore is really bad, but it's the same thing out here too, and you can go across the country and it's going to be consistent across the country. And that's what food depression is. And you see that that you have to think, like, why are there no grocery stores in the hood? That's set up that way. You know, they're planning, there's zoning laws and then planning and stuff like that, that things are specifically placed where they are for a reason. All right. And urban neighborhoods and rural towns. All right. Yeah, I already said that. They don't have healthy food in there. All right. So, and this is what they call it, a food desert, but let's break down the word desert. And I mean, when you think about desert, what do you think? You think dry lands, no water, something that was created in nature. But it's not a food desert if it's purposely put there. That means it's systemically underserved areas. That means these areas are not served on purpose. There are no grocery stores in this area on purpose. There are no fruits and vegetables in this area on purpose. Now I have to switch it over, and I'm going to talk. I was telling you guys a little bit about marketing, but my partner, my wife, is a photographer, and I feel like it's best for her to explain that from the eye of a photographer. I'm going to see that. So placement is important. You can see it just by driving around. I implore you to do your own homework, drive around. Most of you already seen it. A lot of you live in these neighborhoods where we, you know, they're labeled as ghettos or inner city areas where they don't have any food, or, you know, the education system is all jacked up or whatever. It's not clean. And the question is, you know, how did it get that way? And it's important to ask because it's a big part of food too, and a lot of people don't understand why. So, zoning laws. What zoning laws are, zoning laws started in the 1900s, and the way they were doing it is they were using zoning laws. They were called racial zoning laws first in 1900. They're called racial zoning laws, and they were used to funnel the people of color into small areas and into ghettos, kind of like the Trail of Tears that they did with the Indians, put them in the spaces that nobody else wants, and, you know, separate themselves from white people. That's how it went down. And they did that with the schools. You know, schools in the areas that were black people were funneled to didn't get any money. They didn't have, like right now, they don't have money. A lot of kids don't have books. They don't have school. They have school. It's just not a good school. But like all of this stuff is taking place. So that happened in the 1900s. And in 1917, it was deemed unconstitutional to funnel black people and Latino, you know, people of color into an area. They were like, oh, that's not good. We can't do that. But so what they did was they just changed the word from racial zoning to, they just said, we're calling it zoning now, zoning ordinances. And it's not to move black people, it's to remove blight from the communities. And I was like, blight? I had to look that up. I was like, what is that? And they're like, blight. And when they're referring to blight, they just, instead of saying people of color, they said blight. And blight means infection, mold, infestation, and stuff like that. So they just switched the terminology, and they instead of saying racial division, we're just trying to get rid of the blight and preserve the character of the community. And that is, those same words are still used today in zoning laws. And that's why we have the situation that we're in now, where there are food deserts. The food deserts are the systematically underserved areas and stuff like that. And so, so I'm gonna skip. That's my next one. But, I need to go back. this is the part that I forgot. This is important that we understand that zoning law, the why zoning laws are important, because what they do is they funnel all of these, they funnel people of color into these areas, and they saturate them with fast food chains, fast food restaurants, McDonald's, Burger King, blah, blah, blah. There's no grocery stores. So all that's available to eat are fast food chains or corner store bodega type. That's all that's available. And then the majority of people that live in these inner city areas, you know, it's not a secret. They're not living the best. They're working 2-3 jobs. A lot of them don't have cars. So they don't have a way to get 3 miles away to the grocery store that's outside of their city, outside of their town. And then two, there have been a number of studies that show that why this setup and these zoning laws are detrimental to the people who live in that society. There's countless studies by Harvard and all over that the people who live in these areas, in these inner city areas, are not the healthiest. They're dying 30 years sooner than everyone else that lives outside of the areas. They're obese. They have the diseases that they have, diabetes, stroke, heart disease, are running rampant in those areas. And then another testament to that is that people of color, this is nationwide, it started, all this, the land zoning started in the South, it started heavily in Baltimore, but then it spread its way to California, across the country, and they were using it in cities where the black population was starting to climb. They had to funnel all the black people into one space, and all the brown people, and even here in Oakland, they use it a lot for Asian people, and they were they were funneling them up and trying to get all their laundromats like out of the city. They don't want anything to do with it. And they were using it to protect the character of their city or stuff like that. And that's why when you drive around now, you see in certain areas, this is they have zoning laws that goes like, it goes in tiers, so 1, 2, 3, whatever. And then the first one is, you can't have no fast food restaurants in this area. So where there's rich houses, billionaires, millionaires, and nice, you know, you have the Prada stores and Gucci stores, there's not gonna be any fast food. And what they deem fast food is exactly what it is, food that's pre-prepared, and it goes and it's shipped to McDonald's, and then they warm it up and heat it up and serve it to you. But what they can have in those spaces are restaurants and stuff like that, which is healthier food. And then when you go into when you get into more nicer areas, say where it's like a kind of a mix, or it's like, you know, where the millennials live, there'll be, you can only have 9 fast food restaurants within this distance, and that's it. But then when you go into the inner city areas, there's no cap. There's no cap on how many fast food restaurants. That's why you'll see on one street, there'll be 2 McDonald's on one street, or there'll be a Burger King, a Jack in the Box, and KFC within all on the same block. That's why we have these. So it's important for us to understand how the situation got to, I mean, how we got into the situation that we're in, and why there's such a saturation in the hoods or in the urban areas. And what is happening now is that a lot of people in the communities are becoming aware of these laws, and they're fighting against them, and fast food companies they're like, oh, we can't, it's not racist to have these urban areas be saturated with fast food. They're trying to come up with so many excuses to fight that. But, and like I said, there's been so many studies showing that that fast food causes so many diseases. And to me, it seems like people of color have always been pushed into unhealthy foods. And then that's where this slide comes in. That's where this slide comes in. And I was telling you how, okay, so this is interesting for us to know how soul food got to be soul food. So a lot of people probably know this, but a lot of people don't. The reason why we have soul food is not soul food, it's slave food. The reason we got soul food was because the slave masters, when we got brought over here, or the slaves that got over here, and the indigenous people that were here were turned into slaves, then, you know, the slave masters had to feed them. So what were they feeding them? The leftovers. The stuff that is considered soul food today. Pig's feet, chitlins, collard greens, the stuff that was, the vegetables that were so bitter that you had to cook them for hours and hours for them to taste good. Pig's feet. Who in the hell wants to eat someone else's feet? That don't make no sense. And so we were given all the bad food, and it was handed down by the slave owners. And how does this equal? How does this compare to what's going on today? Look what's going on. And you have the nice neighborhoods that are full of food. You have Whole Foods, this and how my wife was saying earlier, we're being priced out of all the good food, but being priced in into all the bad food, which is McDonald's, KFC, churches, and so on and so forth. And that's it. It's still the same thing that's going on. It's just been transformed and manipulated in a way so that it's subtle and that we can't really see it. So it's important that we understand what's going on. And McDonald's is doing the same thing that soul food did, and now it's being, and that's not a good thing. Soul food is like, it's, you know, there's a lot of arguments in the black community. Oh, soul food, you can't talk about soul food like that. Well, I mean, look at the history of it, and then look at the health of people of color today. You look at us, we're 17% of the population, but we're the number one sufferers of heart disease, stroke, diabetes, cancer, obesity. These are, and all these things that I've named, like 80% of them are on the top 10 list of killers that has been posted by the CDC. And this is how you know, like, they don't have to kill us out here in the police with the cops and stuff. They're shooting us, you know, so they can kill us with the food, and it could be very subtle. No one needs to know, unless you know your history. All right, and then speaking of history, I'm gonna talk to you about Christopher Columbus, because this is interesting. A lot of people don't know this about him, but Christopher Columbus, before he came, it was nice, and you know, there was a lot of things that weren't taking place in the United States. But when Chris came, you know, he brought some gifts. So, right? Colonization is one of them. And we see colonization. A lot of people don't know what colonization is. It's just taking over the land, you know. Like, for example, California used to be Mexico. And now it's not. Now it's America. they're colonizing and taking over the lands, taking over the tradition and all that stuff. Smallpox, that's another thing, that was nice. And then cows. A lot of people don't know this, but before Christopher Columbus came to the Americas, cows didn't exist here. They weren't here. But when Christopher Columbus came to the Americas, he saw this land, he saw what the opportunity, and he's like, oh, we can take this over. So in order to come and have these lands, we need to bring our religion to take over the lands to colonize. You need to bring your religion, you need to bring your culture, and you need to bring your food. And the things that they brought with them were cows. And along with cows came milk and cheese. And the practice of milking and cheesing came from Spain. That had nothing to do in here. In Africa, they don't have cows. And out here, they didn't have cows. The practice of milking came from Spain. It's not the indigenous peoples that were here. They didn't eat any milk, and they didn't drink milk. They didn't eat cheese. It was a plant-based diet. And you can look at the China study that shows that even Asian people, in Asia, they don't drink a lot of milk, and they don't eat cheese or anything like that. It's not even in their diet. It's not even in their makeup. The only reason that milk and cheese and sour cream are in America is because of colonization. You can look at the Mexican cuisine, and you look at Mexican cuisine, you look at a taco, a real Mexican taco, there's no cheese on the taco. There's no sour cream on the burritos. But that when you get closer to America, to California, Texas, it's Tex-Mex, and there's only sour cream and cheese and stuff. The burrito's not even Mexican food. That was made up in America. A lot of people don't know that. All right. And then to prove my point even further, we can look at the rates of lactose intolerance in people of color. Not just black people of color, period. Asian people, 90 to 100% lactose intolerant. Indigenous North Americans, which are Indians, 80 to 100% lactose intolerant. The list goes down. Asian, African, African American. Everybody is 75% or more lactose intolerant. But then when you get down here to the Caucasian people, you see that they're only 5 to 15% lactose intolerant. So you see that the rules of the laws that are made for milk and dairy, like for example, the milk law in schools, is inherently racist because this shows, all these studies show that people of color are lactose intolerant. Now let me explain to you about the milk laws in America, the milk laws in the schools, in some of the schools. It started in the South back in the day, and they started giving it to in the urban communities to people of color. They were like, oh, kids are starving. We're going to give them milk to make them, to fatten them up and help them out. They tried to say, we're too ill, we don't have enough strong people to fight the wars, and so they started feeding black people in the urban communities milk and cheese and stuff. That's what I said. They made it mandatory for students to drink milk, to get the milk on the tray, and take a sip of the milk. And in order to, and so they started that in the black communities and all this stuff, and it's happening now. But if most people, all people of color, most of them, 90%, 75%, whatever, more lactose intolerant, why is it a school law for every student to drink the milk before they throw it out? That means that rule, that law is inherently racist. It's made for white people who were only 5 to 10% lactose intolerant, not people of color who were 70, 90, 100% lactose intolerant. And so it's very important for us to know the history of things, how things came to be, like the milk laws, like zoning laws. And this explains why the areas that we live in are in the situation that they are now. The ghettos are the way that they are now. Why obesity is such a high rate for younger kids. And it's because the laws are not set up for everyone. The laws are not inclusive. These laws were put in place in the 1900s, early, when it was racist in the state, and it's still racist now, but when it was blatantly racist in this country. Like I'm forgetting something. Let's see. So the solution is, all right, so these are solutions. We got racism in the laws. It's important for people, for everyone, to know the laws and how they came to be. And it's like, because otherwise, all they're doing, like I said, is just changing the words and changing it up a little bit so that way they can just slide by with rules. Like, oh, it's okay, let's just change it from racial zoning to blight. Right, we're not going to say we're going to move the black people out of the neighborhoods and the Asians and the Mexicans out of the neighborhoods to protect our zones where we're living. We're just going to call it community, whatever. So that's what they're doing. It's important for us to understand. So solutions taking that, start demanding, for one thing, start demanding healthier foods in your local grocery stores. Because supply and demand is important. If you go to your bodega, if you live in an area where you don't have a real grocery store, go to your local bodega, talk to the owner and say, you know, we would like some fruits and vegetables. If you put fruits and vegetables in here, we'll buy them. And then that's gaining some kind of ground, because that's better than having nothing. You know, start reducing meat or take it out altogether. Like I said, I'm giving you proof that, you know, people of color are not, we're not supposed to be drinking milk. It's proven, or not most of us at least. And then two, also a big thing that's going on in the black community is diabetes. Black people, we call it the sugars, you know? But the reality is that, yes, sugar has a part to play in it, but a lot of people don't know what diabetes really starts from. Alright, so first, let me break it down. My dirt is about to come out. But, okay, so anyway, so when we eat meat has saturated fat. Saturated fat is only found in animal products and oils that are man-made and are solidified, like Crisco or, unfortunately, coconut oil. I love coconut oil. Anyways. And what it does is it goes to your pancreas. When you eat saturated fat, it goes to your pancreas where insulin is made in your body. And insulin is what regulates your sugar levels in your body, right? So the saturated fat goes to your pancreas, chokes out your beta cells, which create insulin for your body, and then you become diabetic. UCLA just released a study that says 50% of California is pre-diabetic and they don't even know it. So, and that's why, you know, we're under the assumption that diabetes is caused by the sugars. Sugars does play a role in diabetes, but it's really the meat that you're eating is choking down your defense mechanism, your sugar level, the thing that balances your sugar levels, which is your pancreas and your beta cells, literally choking them out. So it's important for us to know this information, and know, and that's what I'm saying, like, the soul food's been killing folks since forever. And a lot of people don't know that one fried drumstick is equivalent to eating a stick of butter when it comes to saturated fat. So think about that next time you chomp on a piece of Popeye's chicken. Find and start your own plant-based eating and exercise groups in the area. There are a lot of, they're starting to happen now more and more, but urban gardens. Start trying to grow something in your backyard if you have one. You know, food banks, you know, reach out to your local community. There are a lot of groups out there that are trying to get into the urban communities and make a difference when it comes to getting healthy food into people's homes. Do your own research and get informed. I just play football. I'm not a scientist. I'm not a doctor. None of this like that. I just do my own research, and I'm passionate about, you know, the information that I receive. So do your own research and become informed yourself, and find out how you can help yourself. Don't rely on a doctor whose job isn't to prescribe you medication and tell you, oh, like when you get cancer, oh, now you gotta do chemotherapy. But they neglect to tell you that chemotherapy is a 97% failure rate. They don't tell you that. And it's the only legal form of cancer treatment. Chemotherapy and surgery, they both have 97% failure rate. Both of those are the only legal form of cancer treatment in the United States. You wonder why that is. Why you gotta put a cap on it. They don't think people, but that's bad. Telling people the same, you're different. We have a different mindset than these people. You know, doctors are like politicians. They can tell you a lie to keep the money coming in. You know, there's no money in the cure. You are a plant-based doctor, which is different. You're prescribing medicine and all that. I mean, medicine through vegetables and trying to eat better to live better. But for other doctors, they don't even give you 15 minutes before you have to, you know, just for checkup. How are you getting a checkup? What are you checking on my body in 15 minutes to tell me that that I'm healthy or unhealthy? So it's not just the doctors. There may be a few doctors like you who are plant-based doctors who are saying this, but it's not just the doctors, it's the system.
I agree.
So, all right, one thing, okay, then I said, do your own research. Don't beat yourself up in changing your lifestyle. It takes time. I did it overnight, but I'm special. And remember, you only have one body. You only, and I say this all the time, and it's different. Like a lot of, when people talk to me all the time, they ask me these questions. Oh, so is veganism, it's not weak, it's still masculine, right? And I'm thinking like, man, first of all, what is masculinity? And then two, it's like because like, it's masculine, it's a broad definition of masculinity. It could be anything. People think beating someone up is masculine, or going, or eating meat is masculine. No, it's not. You know, it's a responsibility is really what it is. It's, you know, anyway, I'm gonna get off of it. But anyway, as a father, if I was a father, I don't have any kids or nothing like that. But if I had kids, I'm not gonna feed them food that I know that gonna cause issues for them later on in the future. That is literally poisoning your child. You can be a mother, father, whatever. Poisoning your child if you give them, just something simple as French fries, has 11 different cancer-causing ingredients in them. Know that. A hot dog. The World Health Organization just deemed that eating 4 hot dogs is equivalent to smoking a pack of cigarettes. So next time you feed your child a hot dog, you think it's just a hot dog, it's just meat, no it ain't. So it's important for you to learn about this information because we're talking, there's a lot of talk about, black people of color feel like, there's a mission to take us out. But if we don't educate ourselves, then they don't have to take us out. We're taking our own selves out. We're worried about police shooting us. We're shooting ourselves in the mouth with a fork, So it's important for us to understand this knowledge, understand the knowledge, understand what it is that we're eating. Read the labels on the back. If you can't pronounce it, don't eat it. You know that Doritos, how many of y'all eat Doritos in here? Raise your hand if you eat it. I know some of y'all eat Doritos. You eat Doritos? Did you know that Doritos use beaver butt juice to flavor their chips, so you can be mad all day. You too, you laughing. Yeah. But that's what I'm saying. You need to know the ingredients that are in your food. You need to know the ingredients that are in your food because they can be feeding you anything. And then when at the end of the day, if things start happening, you have health complications, or you wonder why, because a lot of the ingredients in Doritos chips also cause brain damage and all kind of other stuff like that. You have issues further down the road, they're just going to tell you, oh, well, that's your job. You should know what you're eating. That's not our fault. You bought our product and you ate it. It's not our fault once it exchanges hands. You need to educate yourself. And the thing about that is, too, I'm going to touch on GMOs real quick and I'm going to jump off the stage. But it's important for you to know what you're eating and not eat genetically modified foods either, because 23 diseases have increased exponentially since the production of genetically modified organisms in foods. 23 major diseases, and new diseases are coming up left and right. And this is since the development of GMO foods and since the 90s. So it's important for us to know this information, and then I think.
I had two questions. One was about your brother. I'm wondering if he does plant-based, the one who does NFL.
No, he's not plant-based, but he still plays. He's a linebacker.
Is he open to it, though? Like,
he's open to it, but my brother is, I would like to call, brainwashed. He doesn't understand. He doesn't listen to it because I'd be like, bro, what's protein? It's meat, man. He's one of those guys. He's one of those macho, I'm eating cleaner. So I started eating, white meat chicken and all that. I was like, all right, man. I asked him one time, yeah, man, GMOs. Oh, you mean on investments? I'm like, what? So, he's just like on the total opposite scale. Like, he does mergers and acquisitions. Like, he has two jobs. He does football and he does mergers and acquisitions as well. And it's just totally different. Like, he works for the man and I'm against the man. So we're just totally different.
And also just about coconut oil. Is it saturated oil? And coconut oil is kind of, I've heard two sides, that one is it's okay, this plant-based, another that's not.
See, they're all plant-based. The saturated oils are made from nuts and stuff like seed or whatever, like the canola oils and stuff. But Crisco, that's all saturated oils and then hardened. The coconut oil is different in the makeup. I read some articles on that as well, but I use coconut oil really on the outside. much of it. It tastes good, it smells good when you cook it, but you know, I try to stay away from it as much as possible. But I use it just my extensions. I don't know if that's not what you asked, but that's what I'm telling you.
Any other individual here?
Yeah, I was hoping you could expand a little bit. You started to talk about gender performance and the performance of masculinity with meat-based diet and how it's like that's a big reason that folks are hesitant to move towards veganism, towards a plant-based diet. It's just, but like you touched on it, and then you moved on. I was wondering if you could
So there are some interesting studies that have gone with masculinity and veganism, and one of the main things that stick out to me is testosterone levels in males that switch over to a plant-based diet. So they've done studies in that meat eaters and vegetarians, they have lower levels than vegan men, lower levels of testosterone than vegan men do. And, you know, that's because if you look at it, like, your arteries and everything are clogged up, your body is not functioning with ease. So obviously, because, you know, saturated fat and probably heart disease and all that stuff, you're more likely to have those issues. Also, erectile dysfunction is something that is heavy in people who are meat eaters. Because if you think about the male anatomy and what the penis is, it fills up with blood. So saturated fat and cholesterol, they clog up your arteries. If the artery that goes to fill up your member it's clogged up with animal fats and cholesterol and all that stuff, then you're not going to be working with nothing. It's going to be a man out there. You know, you don't got action. So it just really shows that, like, you know, what's the, and then I told you about how, you know, you're feeding your kids, you're feeding your children death, you're putting their health at risk. So there's a lot of things, like, when you get to masculinity itself, it's a very sensitive subject, and I don't want to get too much too deep into it, but that's something, those things right there, that's something that people who talk about masculinity, that's what they refer to as, you know, sex and being a beast in the bed. Well, if it don't work, you're not going to be a beast in the bed, so that just eliminates you from being the big macho man, right? And that's what he is, or you might as well just go buy a big old Porsche now, because you ain't. And then also too, health, you're not gonna be fit. You're not gonna look good. It's your health. Like, if you're trying to attract a woman, you know, it's harder for you to attract a woman if you don't look the part, if you don't look in shape. That's what, you know, women use their eyes to look at you, okay, who's fit, to mating partner. That's just nature, that's just how, or I don't wanna get too deep into it.
We have a few more questions too.